Hi, Angela from Urender here. In this video of the beginner tutorial series, we are gonna go through post-processing and effects. We are gonna talk about ambient occlusion, bloom, tone mapping, chromatic aberration, vignette, and color correction. In the last two videos, we already did the lighting of the scene and created the materials of the dragon. Make sure to check them out. Let me show you where you can download the trial. Request a Urender trial license. Download Urender for Cinema 4D. Run the installer. If you need help installing Urender, check out our trial installation video guide to take a look at the installation manual. Then open the folder according to your Cinema 4D version. Now copy the Urender folder, go to your preference folder, plugins folder, and paste. Restart Cinema and open Urender Studio. Click on Manage License and copy the key that you received by email and click on Activate. This dragon scene will follow us through the entire beginner tutorial series from start to finish. You can download the scene and all the in-between steps. Just head to our website, downloads, examples and assets and scroll down. Let's start by activating Urender and make sure to use our Urender layout. We are going to the render settings, Urender effects. We will talk about the motion blur and depth of field in the next video when we are going to talk about the cameras. So let's continue with ambient occlusion. As you can see, the hemisphere AO is activated by default. Ambient occlusion defines if a point is lit by ambient light and is used to add realism. It is a method to approximate how bright light should be shining on any specific part of a surface based on the light and its environment. With Urender, you can choose between hemisphere AO and ground truth AO. The hemisphere ambient occlusion method has smoother results than the ground truth ambient occlusion, but this method can achieve a more detailed result. Just remember, if there's no ambient light set, there are also no occluded areas. You can either set an ambient light in the render settings with the ambient light color, or the environment map and enable diffuse IVL. Just a quick tip, when you change your settings and you want to set it to default, you might know that you can just right click reset to default, but there's a much quicker way. Just go here to these little arrows and simply click with the right mouse button. Sometimes the ambient occlusion can cause artifacts, and to fix them you have to adjust the near and far clipping values in the camera tag. But if you use the hemisphere AO method, you can also try to raise the hemisphere offset value. Starting with the hemisphere ambient occlusion. This method is fast and, as I already mentioned, results are smoother than the ground truth ambient occlusion. The radius defines the distance, geometry occludes nearby areas. With the strength, you can adjust the power of darkening. And higher sample values cause longer render times. With the hemisphere offset, you can achieve a more detailed results with small amounts if objects are very close to each other. When you use a spherical camera, please use the hemisphere AO. Next is the ground truth ambient occlusion. This method is more advanced and is great if fine details are needed. Here we also have the radius, which defines the distance. Geometry occludes nearby areas. The max range limits the visible range of the ground truth AO. Higher sample steps values provide smoother results. The strength defines the darkening. Fast preview filter can greatly increase performance while working in live mode. It can cause artifacts, check this off for final rendering. Enable depth peeling to prevent halos. This option uses depth peels to look behind objects. You can activate this if you like to include the back faces. If there are still halos visible, you can increase the depth layer's current. For our dragon scene, we're gonna use the ground truth AO. We will just increase the sample steps to max 32 and the strength to 3. We have an ambient occlusion quick tip video on our channel too. Continuing with the bloom, it is the artifact effect of camera lenses that cause bright light to fade outside from bright areas. Firefly reduction is activated by default. It helps to reduce the bright spots, fireflies, and also helps to get rid of flicker. It also limits the luminance of the image overall, and higher intensity means brighter bloom. The inner weight controls the intensity on the inside, same as for the outer weight. So if you want to decrease the radius of the bloom, just reduce the outer weight. In general, bloom can brighten up your scene a little too much and make it look washed out. This can be counteracted by setting up an S-curve with the color correction filter. I will explain the color correction filter later on too. I will leave the bloom on and decrease the intensity to 0.5. Now we can move on to the post-processing tab. Tone mapping is enabled by default. It is in general the process of remapping the HDR values of an image so that it is suitable to display on screen. It prevents the render result from clipping too wide. There are different modes, linear, exponential and Reinhardt. I'm just gonna use exponential this time. HSV model is activated by default, I usually don't deactivate it. Its purpose is to compensate unwanted hue shift when working with high reflective materials. Next one is the exposure. It increases the brightness of your render. But be aware that clipping can occur in bright areas. With the black point you can make your render darker. The most important setting for tone mapping is the white point. We are gonna increase the exposure to 2 and bring down the white point a little bit, 1.5. Here you can choose your output color format, color space, to adjust the gamma value of your image. You can change to sRGB, linear and custom gamma. You will use the output format setting to make sure the gamma matches what Cinema 4D is expecting. The custom gamma allows you to set any gamma value you need. With sRGB, the image will be gamma corrected for sRGB. Use linear if you want to keep your image in linear space. Next one, the chromatic aberration. With chromatic aberration, you can achieve color fringing. High contrast areas like the edges are blurred with specific colors. High values will cause more blur to the edges of the image. I will turn down the chromatic aberration to 2. Here you can turn on the vignette, which reduces the brightness of your render, at the image border. With this you can draw more attention to the center of the image. You can adjust the radius, softness and strength. For this scene I will use vignette, but only bring down the strength to 30%. With the color correction tool, you can do all your changes directly here without going to Photoshop or other programs. Adjust the saturation, brightness, contrast, and gamma. You can turn on the red, green and blue filter and adjust their curves separately. I will show what we like to do from a saturation and general color correction. Select both points of the curve. Right click and go to point type soft. Now drag these both handles and make the S-curve. You will see that your image will be quite saturated. See the difference? You can do that with the curves in the other channels RGB too. In case you mess up, you can always reset the default with right-click reset. You can adjust the overall strength of the color correction filter with the strength. That's it for effects and post-processing. In the next video we are gonna talk about cameras in general and motion blur, depth of field and 360 degrees camera. The last video of the series will be a sum up of the dragon scene. Here are some examples of scenes how they look like without effects and post-processing. Hope you liked this video, see you in the next one and thanks for watching.